Good evening. Hello, nice to see you all. Whoops, I dropped my paper. So tonight's event is the last one this semester in a loose sequence of events focused on technology. A few weeks ago, we had a series of speakers here that discussed the implications of design technologies as agents of change. And at that event, we looked at aspects of design speculation, practice, automation and construction, and those were the four aspects. With our focus tonight on facades, we're likely to be affected by all of those four aspects of design practice, automation, and fabrication. And I think facades, as no other element in architecture, collapses not just the challenges and opportunities of design and performance. Recently, I think more so than ever before, facade design has become a design laboratory of sorts that has integrated new forms of practice, innovative fabrication methods, and new materials. The facade is loaded with expectations from all stakeholders, not just from the architect, but certainly from the consultants, engineers, fabricators, and after all, the client and the occupants of the building. The design of the facade is crucial not only for practical reasons, but even more so as we consider the envelope as the interface between the building and the public sphere. In recent years, the firm of Front has become almost synonymous with advancement in the design of sophisticated facade systems. Front specializes in envelope systems for new construction, including curtain walls, hybrid cladding systems, and the use of structural glass and related lightweight structures. Their portfolio of work ranges in size and complexity from high-rise buildings to public and cultural institutions, as well as private residences. Tonight, we're very happy to have one of the founding partners of Front with us, Marc Simmons. Working with Front, Marc has consulted on numerous high-profile projects in recent years, including the Central Public Library in Seattle by OMA, the linked hybrid housing complex in Beijing with Stephen Holl Architects, the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis with Herzog De Meuron, and the Morgan Library and Museum in New York with Renzo Piano Building Workshop. Marc holds degrees in environmental studies and architecture from the University of Waterloo, and he built his expertise in facade design previously before Front with Foster and Partners with Meinhardt Facade Technology and Dewhurst McFarlane and Partners in New York, a company specialized in structural glass and facade consulting work. He's currently teaching at Princeton University. Welcome, please, Marc Simmons. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Martin. Thank you, Mosen. Thank you, Chantel, for inviting me here to the GSD to talk to you tonight about a little bit of work that we're doing. Just a quick word before I launch into the projects. Front is a multidisciplinary design and engineering consulting practice. We ultimately work on our own kind of terms in terms of how we engage and what we engage in. And in that sense, it is very much a kind of like, a personal, project. The firm is really an entity to allow the individuals within the company to engage in practice on the terms that it chooses. And in that sense, we're not very corporate, but we are very global. It's a small firm, anywhere between usually 30 to 40 staff. And we now have offices in New York, Seattle, San Francisco, and Hong Kong, mainly to address individuals' desire for specific lifestyles, mostly, but also to address the global nature of our clients, like my Asian clients kicking me in the butt, saying, I'm not going to pay for your stupid business class tickets anymore until you put feet on the ground in Asia. So those are the realities, and that's what motivates us to move into Asia. Of course, we've been doing work there for 10 years, and we now have an office in Hong Kong. We see building really as such a fundamental core existential act. And We are profoundly interested in who our clients are. We're interested in the architects we work with. We're interested in the artistic reasons, the cultural reasons, the political reasons, the economic motivations, and particularly the kind of uses of these buildings. In that sense, we're not agnostic about the projects we work on and who we work for. So there's always this kind of critical understanding that pervades the entire practice moving forward for the last 10 years to understand what game we're playing in. And I have to say, we haven't taken a particularly strong moral position relative to the work as maybe some practices have. And I say that because a lot of it is luxury retail, which is largely indefensible. A lot of it is very high-end private residences, which are largely indefensible. But many of it is actually quite nice institutional work or often larger scale, quite responsible, quite meaningful housing projects. So we are engaging in all kind of aspects of making a better world, but at the same time indulging ourselves in guilty pleasures. So the sequence I'm going to show right now, which is very significant, like in the number of images, there's a lot of images, and so I'm going to go quickly, and I'm going to tell little vignettes about each job that focus generally on a given material, a given system, a given problem, and then through that, I think you'll, you know, with the kind of like the beauty shots and renderings, you'll immediately understand, of course, the nature of the job. And a lot of it's very well published, so you'll probably have already seen much about these projects, or a few of them anyway. But what kind of permeates the sequence is the key artifacts of production, which for me are really samples, trial assemblies, mock-ups, visual mock-ups, and performance prototypes, and various kinds of tests. And some projects don't have that representation, but most of them do. And you'll see that, for me, those artifacts are the kind of exemplary, the built record of key moments in a process, you know, hinging somewhere between the design stages and the execution stages as a somewhat point of inflection. And Martin and I were just discussing earlier that, of course, all of these mock-ups, as with hand sketches and other kinds of drawings, they derive from fundamental questions that you should be asking initially about what is the nature of the problem you're trying to solve. And then you ask yourself, well, what kind of verification do I need? Do I need a drawing? Do I need a sketch? Do I need a mock-up? Do I need to experience something at full scale? Do I need to actually go and see another building, which is, say, a precedent or a reference? And there's always this kind of amazing process of trying to come to empirical understanding of the thing you're designing in every aspect. I mean, you know, the subtlety of formal aspects of the project, you know, if you're interested in certain phenomenological effects, I mean, how do you actually verify and understand that? And, you know, building certain types of artifacts will yield a knowledge that allows you then with confidence to move forward and take the risk to build the real thing. So you'll see much of that. The other thing that permeates this, and I talk to it all the time, is, of course, constructability and economics. They're fundamentals, and they're often very much geographically and culturally based, depending on where things are made, where they're installed, what the labor market is like, you know, logistical constraints and so forth. And those things always play into dialogue relative to the actual basic brief for the building, whether it's the design intent or the program or what have you. Okay, so the first project here is a luxury residential project designed by Jean Nouvel on the West Side Highway in Manhattan. And this project is, I can tell you, the major concern, of course, it does have these wonder kind of formal aspects. There's like the complexity of the window patterns, the three-dimensionality of the mullion caps and so forth, which, as you can see in this image, begin to sort of collapse into this strange other facade that becomes manifest only on the oblique, which is highly, highly intentional. But really, the way this was composed is completely from the inside out. Each floor has approximately seven spaces on a floor facing this particular facade. And each one of those rooms might be a bedroom from 15 feet wide up to, say, a living room at 37 feet wide. And what we wanted, what Jean wanted, was to have a curtain wall panel with a nonlinear load path without the evidence of, shear block splice type connections. We wanted something monolithic. We wanted something welded. We wanted something where the index of constructability, which is typically the movement joint, was deferred to the edges of the space to the point where, from the interior, your composition of the window per se is actually just a single pre-assembled unit. Now, we went to Germany. We had discussions with Seeley and Gartner, and we could not afford them. The owner insisted on going to China, so we went to China, and we could afford it. But we can only afford it with containerization. Of course, the height of the panels requires open-top containers, but the 40-foot container length became a governing parameter in the design of the interior spaces. So one curtain wall panel was determined to be a maximum of 37 feet long, which then became the widest space in the floor planning of the building. And so all this was actually done quite earlier in the process. So here you can now see the kind of regulating geometry. Originally, there was no kind of regulating grid on the facade, but you can see the vertical continuous lines. You can see the floor slabs, because, of course, we need fire stops and other things like that in order to compartmentalize the residential units. And this is one of the earlier projects where we started playing with, you know, generative wireframes and instantiating various components in order to try and manage the complexity. For me, the job's not about that. In fact, somebody kind of got upset with me once because it wasn't, algorithmically generated. It was actually completely hand-composed, which I totally support because it was done so for all the right reasons. So here's your first full-scale visual mock-up, and this is done relatively early in the process, and then bang, you're into production materials, basically brought in from New Jersey on low-riding flatbeds, and this is a kind of sense of the interior space with these kind of continuous welded frames. Very brief note on Zaha Hadid project that we're doing up in Michigan. It's actually mostly complete, but this is the Broad Art Museum in East Lansing. And I just have a couple of quick images here of really quite conventional materials, but trying to use, you know, V-cut, break-formed, Alucobond or Renabond-type panels to try and achieve these aesthetics. So there was a huge amount of kind of, you know, value engineering that went on in this, and then a lot of visual mock-ups to essentially verify that we could preserve design intent using very conventional low-cost techniques. And then, of course, all the geometry, the complexity comes in really, the V-cutting, the folding, all the off-cutting that goes on to create these panels. And this is a visual mock-up, understanding the interface between the vertical interior slotted windows and then the folded metal panels that create the overall aesthetic. And if you look at that for just a moment and you step back and you say, okay, well, that's what it's relating to, it becomes kind of less abstract. There's a project we did with Bob Siegel, very, very inexpensive facade. This is the land port of entry border crossing station built by Homeland Security between Canada and the United States up in New Brunswick. And really, this is mainly just a stucco building with punch windows, incredibly inexpensive. It's just a shed. And, you know, using techniques that were already adapted from projects like the Walker Art Center and other kind of stamped metal facades, you know, the GSA was actually very interested in using that kind of approach because it had, very desirable visual effects. It also had security benefits, not from a blast mitigation or anything like that. It was really more about visibility. When you look at the building from the outside, from the road, you actually can't see through all the windows, and of course from the inside, it allows for great visibility. So what we're doing is we're doing stamping of expanded metal mesh as an industrial product, and on this job, we just essentially invited the same people we work with on the Walker, which was MG McGrath out of Minnesota, to come in and work with us. And by this time, we had kind of like already understood the methodology quite well, and so we could repurpose it. And so Bob Siegel was quite taken with the notion of replicating a geometry that felt more as a kind of metaphorical analog for the landscape in that region, and then used these very conventional prefab panels. You can see the construction approach is incredibly simple. You can see the stucco wall in behind here with these rails. But in the end, it is the dominant formal expression of the building, and it's used very, very broadly. The panelization, as you can see, has this kind of earthquaking, staggered approach. And it's now, it's being pushed by the GSA as an exemplary project to demonstrate how to do very cost-effective and significant work for them. And we note that the kind of budget range for a project like this is far, far different from the courthouses and the other kind of high-end institutional projects. This is really just an infrastructural shed. But Bob managed to also organize the building with this kind of like double split bar configuration, one for trucks, one for civilian vehicles, and then the other one in the middle managed to design this kind of like landscape garden, which is really only for the I believe the occupants of the building. It may also be a rest stop, actually, for people passing through. But I don't think people have that much motivation to stop. Okay, so you may recognize this. I understand Rem was here just a little while ago, and he visited CCTV just about a week before I did, about 6 weeks ago. And the building's very dirty right now. They really need to clean it. They all know it, but apparently there's some sort of political reason why they're not cleaning it, which we don't understand. But the interiors are spectacular. We didn't do the interiors, but we're so happy to kind of be there and go and see it. And I have some images for you. But CCTV, I'm going to talk, of course, only about one aspect of the facade, which relates to performance. Now, we're collaborating with Rory McGowan's team at Arup Structural. Did a fantastic job, obviously, on this project. And one thing you'll note about the building is it has a two-story structural nodal configuration. So this node, this is the smallest diamond on the building, and it's basically two stories at a time. And that's significant because all the floor plates have to be nodally concentric in order to build up the stability system of the whole building. So every second floor is what you call a non-diaphragm floor plate. And if you actually look at the building, every second floor slab is super thin and has all these notches around it, basically to disengage it from the other parts of the structure. And that's totally unique. I mean, that's very unusual to do that. What it means, though, is if you watch my hands, is each floor slab is moving like this during an earthquake, and you can't hang a curtain wall on it. Go figure. Next requirement is you take a blast mitigation requirement over the entire building up 51 stories, and you overlay that onto the structure. So now, because of the particular geometry of the building and the fact that you have this massive 1 million square foot overhang structure, the columns could all be concrete encased and hardened against blast, but also for buckling. Whereas all the diagonal braces, in which case take loads as large as some of the column elements, they're just so big. They themselves cannot be concrete encased for ductility reasons in terms of how the whole building behaves. But if you then take a blast requirement laterally against all of those braces which have massive permanent loads from the overhang, they will fail. And so the curtain wall now, because of this geometry with this client, with this set of performance criteria, the curtain wall is a blast protective screen for the primary structure. That's not part of the normal narrative, but I will tell you at the concept design phase, the curtain wall didn't have the diagonal grid expressed on its exterior. There was a diagonal structural grid on the inside, and there was a completely rectangular grid until such time in schematic design where that diagonal representation had to migrate to the surface. And behind those, what look like sort of ornamental tin cans on the facade, are gigantic pieces of steel that have a 350-millimeter crumple zone. When they go plastic from a blast event, it doesn't impose a lateral load into the bracing structure of the primary building. And that's what this curtain wall then has become. So the other thing is then there is then a formal game. Okay, we clearly understand the aesthetics of Bank of China. We understand the Hancock in Chicago. All of these images were put up. There was a big discussion about it. And the idea of actually doing a negative reveal with an element which is actually a primary blast mitigation structure was just irony. It was intentional, willful gamesmanship. And the idea then that because we have to have the steel in there, the mullions no longer have continuity floor to floor. So the chevrons, as we called them, basically now have to hang all of the steel mullions. Now I'm going to circle back to the non-diaphragm floors. So what we do is we hang all the mullions from these local chevrons. We put in local transoms, which lock up every diamond into its own diaphragm. And all the wind load connections back to the structure are both vertically and horizontally slipped. There's no curtain wall in the world that has ever been built like this. It's completely unique. And every individual diamond has its own structural logic, its own stack joint configurations, and so forth, even to the point where there are parts of the building at the top where the stress concentrations are very low. You don't have a lot of these diagonal braces. You have regions of the building that are 9 stories of continuous curtain wall, and they're all hung as well. So within a 9-story region of the building, it's all actually suspended. And so these drawings kind of show you there's a kind of diagonal brace. This is the diagram at this early stage of the kind of steel that's in the facade. And you can start to see the mullion is actually hanging from this floor. And then this one actually has a slip connection with a movement joint at there. And the steel is all legible on the interior of the building. But again, for thermal reasons, we, of course, have to insulate it. We have to waterproof it. And then we have to put an ornamental cladding on top of it. We ideally wouldn't want to do that because it, you know, doesn't speak of certain kinds of truth, but that's what it had to be. So there's all these kind of 3D models visualizing how it would work. We're studying installation sequence, and then ta-da. Of course, this is one of the largest visual mock-up, performance mock-ups we've ever built. Zheng Ho was the curtain wall contractor in Beijing. This is a 18-meter by 23-meter by 3.5-meter performance mock-up. And you can start to see the impact formally that the negative reveal has. It's actually incredibly dramatic, that kind of the depth of that cut. And when you start looking at the building obliquely, it really begins to change your reading of it. It wasn't an ill-informed decision. It was very intentional. So here's with the water racks on it, and then you put the airplane engine in and test it. You can see also here that the mullions are actually all steel, completely off-the-shelf sections. But then the curtain wall is a full unitized drain joint pressure equalized unitized curtain wall system with 65% of the panels all being unique because of the generative geometry of the building. But it has all of that in the extrusion, but what's ripped out of it is all the structural depth, because the structural depth then relies on the mullion as its kind of secondary backup chassis. So the interior reading of this is also very kind of raw and industrial and not really conventional in any way whatsoever. And you can see that this extrusion here relies on structural support. You see the little highlights here? Those are the intermittent wind load restraints legible on the interior of the steel itself. This is more about AirUp. This is a large-scale, full-scale, I think it's copper structural mock-up of the building. These are just indicative frit samples. It's like about 150 different glass samples that were evaluated. The whole building is covered with a matte metallic frit in order to create this kind of like sublime seamlessness over the entire building, which is very much an aesthetic idea. And to convince a client to accept that, to see through it everywhere, was also quite a challenge. And this here, well, that's facade steelwork. So to make the point, behind every one of those kind of negative reveals, which seems to actually dematerialize the entire curtain wall, is one of these. I mean, this is not primary building steelwork. The primary steel is unbelievably huge and complex. So this diagram basically shows it all. You can see here, this is a diaphragm floor. You can see how big the edge beams are. Here's a non-diaphragm floor, super thin. Totally disengaged. The chevrons are going up first, and you can see the steel mullions being installed top down, and you can see that the diagonal elements themselves are not concrete encased, and you can see that the columns are fully concrete encased all the way up the building. So that kind of pretty much explains everything in a single go. And you know what I love about this is it is absolutely a technical response to the design, but it is informed at every point by very, very considered aesthetic decisions. Here you get a sense of the kind of isolation of one individual diamond on the facade. This is courtesy of Ewan Bonn. Spectacular image, which basically catches every single moment in the erection sequence of the steel and this connecting at the top, and then the semi-unitized construction methodology of the curtain wall as it's kind of rising up the building. I'm just going to quickly go through these images, and I'm going to jump onto TVCC. So recently, this is just an image through the glass floors up in the public loop area, and that's the image of the rooftop garden below. And then this is the current status of TVCC, which, as you all know, had a unfortunate construction mishap, if you want to call it that. But right here, you can see the new zinc cladding going onto the building. And it was an incredibly good decision, unfortunate decision, that they did not change the cladding material for the building. They actually considered changing it to painted aluminum and other things, but this was intended to be raw zinc. And on a facade that is this large and subject to corrosion long-term, zinc is simply the best cladding material we could have chosen for long-term durability. There was a lot of politics about the zinc as well, because it can't be fabricated in China. VM zinc and Rhine zinc are the only two major world manufacturers who produce coil-formed zinc, but eventually they bought into it from a technical standpoint, and it's being rebuilt in that way as well. So the cladding for TVCC should be redone, I think, towards the end of the year, and then Mandarin, I think, is opening the hotel towards the end of 2013, which is pretty exciting because, you know, there is always a lot of concern that Mandarin Oriental might also bail on the project, but I think politically that would be a bad move. So we're pretty excited that the whole thing is going to be realized, you know, precisely as imagined. And you can all imagine that during the design of this building, we were all as much excited about this project, if not more, than the large cousin to next door. So I'm just going to take you a little bit through some developmental images of TVCC, which of course also had, TVCC standing for Television Cultural Center, had hundreds of models built, hundreds of study models built by OMA. And yours truly, even as a principal of his own practice, spent overnighters cutting blue foam in OMA's model shop in Rotterdam as a kind of sign of our love and commitment for this project. So here's the raw zinc technical mock-ups that were done at a kind of very early stage. And then this is them weathered out probably in about 2 months. And eventually they get to about full patina after 2 years and to a kind of very soft matte gray finish. And then this is a technical mock-up of the curtain wall system itself, which is a semi-unitized system for the hotels. And then these photographs were all taken before the fire and give you a sense of what was involved in putting together this pixelated curtain wall. Concrete work was hard enough, and then doing the cladding on top of that is quite difficult. So this is going to be pretty similar to what it's going to be in the end. There is this interior wall that probably almost says no one's ever seen. It's actually one of our favorite walls on the whole CCTV mega project. It's a suspended 7-story wall where the mullions are 2'6" on center. And the whole thing is hung from the top, and then these transoms are just steel plate transoms for wind load support. And you can see they also reduce in depth planimetrically as they rise up. And so it actually kind of creates this forced perspective, making the whole thing much, much longer than it actually is. And, you know, the experience on the inside is really quite, quite remarkable. And so those are the major walls that face onto the lobby. And for anyone who doesn't know, there is a direct lineage and reference to Taniguchi's Horiguchi Pavilion in Tokyo, these kind of super slender steel mullions, this kind of Baleen aesthetic almost. This is our largest, tallest project, shall we say, a 400 meter tower for Capital Market Authority in Riyadh with HOK. The building is geometrically already pretty complex, but there's some things that the client is supporting which we're very impressed by. The entire curtain wall is triple glazed. It's a double Lowy coating, gas-filled, insulated units in a very hot climate, and they recognize that if you're going to air condition your building, the U value of the wall matters, so they're supporting that. The next thing is they have supported a horizontal exterior sunshade just above the vision panel, which of course cuts out a lot of light, and then they've supported a cantilevered glass laminated louver to the exterior, which is then optimized relative to sunshade, which at one point was considered maybe to be kinetic, but of course that died very quickly, and now it's a passive element. But it is there. And so you have these two-directional shading systems, which is the best kind of shading you can have in this climate, and then you have a very good U value. So this building is actually doing so many things right from a basic environmental standpoint, and we're not really in support of building cavity walls, per se, around glass buildings in hot climates. It's kind of a recipe for disaster, because cavity walls eventually will fail, and when they fail, you'll basically build a greenhouse around your building in the desert. So unless you're totally committed to absolute maintenance and future performance of your double wall, I would avoid it. So the passive shading system is generally better in tropics. So here's a detail basically showing how those glass assemblies would work. And then the contract got awarded to the same contractor for CCTV. It's Zhang Ho from Beijing. And this is, the mock-up's kind of ugly, but a much larger scale, it actually works pretty well. But you can, this is mainly an interface transition between one of the kind of large zone transitions, and this mock-up is made in China. Changing complete scales, this is the Columbia Journalism School done with Scott Marble and Karen Fairbanks. And this is it's a great little pavilion. It's got a really nice little narrative. The way it works is it sits next to the journalism school between these two existing buildings facing out onto the main quad up at Columbia. And we have a glass skylight. It's all glass. But there's no exterior sun shading. It's just an interior perforated shade, which, you know, Scott's guys did all the fab models for and actually CM'd the production of this thing because it is interior. There's not a lot of risk associated with it. It's very nice. But they what happens here is the sun comes in. It heats up the zone between this sunshade and the glass skylight. And then it gets pulled horizontally out with a series of drum diffusers towards the back. And, of course, I guess the punchline here is that this panel here is 8 foot by 18 feet, and it moves up on synchronized screw jacks. So this whole thing is a 18 by 18 foot double-hung window with each panel of glass weighing approximately 2,800 pounds. So this is with it closed, and this is with it open, and it's meant to be an all-season cafe, so when the weather's good, they open it up. And the air comes in, and then basically because we have the hot at the top, it creates a stack effect. The cooler air gets drawn up, and the air, as I said, gets kind of pulled back and channeled back to the vents at the rear of the thing. And that's why the sunscreen, so to speak, is perforated in itself. So the whole thing is really designed as a little mechanism just to create a continuous breeze during good weather, and otherwise it picks up the passive solar heat gain during the winter when we just keep the door shut. So here's the basic configuration. So you're looking at these synchronized screw jacks, which then we got our friend Dante Martinez in Argentina to fabricate. Most of the components are all Swiss, but the whole thing got assembled in Argentina, tested, and then knocked down, sent to Westchester, and then got fully installed on the site in Columbia University. Now, one of the political aspects of this, which was quite interesting, and I was talking to some of the students here earlier about, is that doing a double-hung screwjack-based wall at Columbia University is really difficult. It's a very conservative institution, and the idea of the maintenance and risks associated with this were very high. And obviously, people like us can design these things, but in the end, we're not going to maintain them, and we're also not going to build them in this particular case. So Dante, fortunately for us, built the, at the invitation of Raphael Vignoli, he built the motorized large louvers at the Princeton Genomics Institute and Princeton University. And because the project was executed so well and the post-completion maintenance and support was so good, that Princeton University was called as a reference, and Columbia said, well, if it's good enough for Princeton, it's good enough for us. And they then he gave his word, and they have been actually happy ever since. And the project has been, to my knowledge, quite a success. So here's the factory where it was done in Westchester, and then the actual system. So here's the glass skylight. You can see the interface between the structure designed by Nat Oppenheimer. And I'll point out one little thing. These are just like small, small details that actually matter. You can see these dumb little cleats that basically lift the skylight purlins off of the steel itself. This is just to make sure that we don't pocket a reservoir in the skylight for the hot air. So the hot air actually can be drawn along the underside of the glass, and it massively changes the performance of the whole thing as a system. This is the hand of the mechanical engineer, Mark Malikshai, who worked with the whole team on this. And that's that. The next series of projects is, it's a project that Front was invited by LVMH to participate in a design competition for a series of facades and for a company called DFS Galleria, and DFS Galleria is a subsidiary of LVMH. And this was a kind of underinvested multi-brand retailer, kind of like Saks, but without the same identity. And what they wanted to do was working with Ogilvy, who's the branding agent and holding this competition for these designs, they wanted to come up with a basic kind of facade language that, of course, could be reinterpreted through a myriad of material and geographical kind of iterations. So the competition included two stores in Hong Kong, one store in Waikiki, and one store in Singapore. And now there's another one that's being looked at in Bali and Taipei. They're mostly Asia-based. so what you're looking at here is essentially, I wouldn't compare the work to Mendelssohn, but his Scogin department stores was definitely kind of like an inspiration in these kind of super strong bands of light. There's always this notion of the horizon being the vitrines, and then there's a kind of an inverted gradient that basically goes up from eye level basically as a field to occupy whatever the field is vertically and horizontally beyond that plane. So what you're looking at here is a recladding to a very large complex on Canton Road in Hong Kong. And the whole facade is stone. It's actually all limestone, which is all custom milled. It's actually got, these renderings don't particularly capture it, but the very complex geometries within a very tight range, as each band has three different surfaces, and each surface has three different textures. And then the bands themselves actually curve in plan very gently. So there is no piece of stone that is consistent throughout the entire thing. So this here now, the renderings can't capture it, but the actual mock-ups, and this is where the mock-ups matter. The mock-ups are really the test for the quality of this thing. So right now you're looking at this limestone, which has a polished finish on the top surface here, a honed finish in the middle, and then a CNC milled, what we call rigatino finish, in the lower band to kind of create the texture as this thing flows through. And so we built first samples, and then we went to a mid-scale mock-up, and then we went to a larger scale mock-up, and then we started adding the various lighting. And these are the kind of effects you start to get with these material explorations. And then finally, we actually built a mock-up, which was like a full-height mock-up at the actual installed datum, in order to evaluate the understanding of the material full scale. And the management of DFS kind of demanded this level of understanding to ensure that they were confident spending all this money. And this is the second variation. This is also in Hong Kong, on Hong Kong Island. It's in the base of a building designed by KPF. What you're looking at here is a folded metal version, kind of like the stone version, but then encased within a vitrine. And what's going on here is kind of an exploration of the abstraction of joints, because one thing that we always struggle with is the indexical nature of joints, and that joints are present because they always represent a logical and rational use of construction materials and technologies. And that's why I think we all can look at a building and see the kind of normative qualities of facades. And then when we look at other buildings, we understand that they're special. And the jointing and materiality of these systems is often one of the kind of key things. And we could tell stories of joints about every single project. So what you're looking at here is the horizontal transom is actually a rolled and curved profile of steel, which incorporates the lighting track. And then this here is actually the vertical joint, which is a frameless joint between the glass. And so the joints have to be there, but they're heavily subordinated relative to the large horizontals as they actually move through this. And it starts to kind of take on slightly unexpected effects in reality. So there's these various mock-ups that we started building. There's also a frit pattern on the glass itself, which is this what we call a Hilbert pattern, which is a continuous line pattern. The line pattern itself goes through modulations of geometrical density to increase opacity and to improve the transparency of the folded metal behind it. And you can start to see here, these three panels that you're looking at all have the frit patterns in them, whereas this piece of glass is actually completely removed. So here you're looking at folded metal, and this metal actually has a different texture and a different finish from those two pieces of metal. The geometry slices through, and you can start seeing the effect of different frit densities, all relative to the large kind of horizontal joint, which has to be there because it's doing the lion's share of the structural work, and of course, it's the light housing, and it has to be of a certain scale. The third version is slightly more organic. There's more geometry to play with. This is a lower cost facade, so they insisted that we do it out of metal, and it's actually painted metal. And again, you know, renderings can only do so much. We actually started to say, well, we want to study what this thing looks like in reality. And the owner starting to get really high on mock-ups, because they're quite excited by them, they said, we want to do full height, and we want to understand what every band here looks like. So this entire part of this mock-up was the first iteration, and we were pretty unhappy with the contrast between the various panels. And if you look at the two panels on the left, while this is relatively subtle, there's actually quite a contrast between these metal panels as you go down. And so the legibility of this kind of tri-banded geometrical sub-indexing between the major bands starts to become very legible. And at the full scale of the whole project, it becomes actually quite wild in terms of the variation of the reflectivity and the quality of the material. So we also did lighting studies of this facade to start kind of getting a sense of what it might feel like. And this is the soffit panel. Okay, so I'm going to move on quickly to Diane von Furstenberg. This is a project we did with Work AC in New York. All of these elements were changed. The whole thing is a facade retention project, so the whole building behind it is completely new. But what I want to just talk about is this thing here. So this project here is a very nice little boutique grid shell, an unusual level of refinement, which is appropriate, I think, for this particular building, because many grid shells are actually quite crude. And this is the workshop of Bellapart in Spain, who was our facade contractor for this. And you can see the quality of the joinery. This was actually in our design intent, that we have this kind of counter-milled mating bar and node, then with tapped holes. And then these screws actually face the glazing side. So on the inside, there's actually no hardware whatsoever and no welds. So here's a first trial assembly. And then you can see the node. the node comes from this kind of totally organic geometry, and there's this game of understanding which plate has priority and privilege over the others. You can see this surface actually continues through to the center. This begins to fold off of that armature, and you're just making all these decisions to create this kind of like object, which then itself is subtractively milled, and then you can see how every bar coming into it is dovetailed with the bolts coming in from the blind side, and then the glass gets skinned over the whole thing. So then the whole thing goes into production, and then, of course, we're doing trial assemblies. We want to actually fit all the pieces together in the workshop to make sure the whole thing is actually working correctly, break it all down, finish it, and then send it to New York and hang it on the building. Some of you may know aspects of this project. There's a staircase running down the middle of the job, which is clad on either side with Swarovski crystals. And this little thing here is a heliostat, which basically takes the light, tracks it, and shoots it down the staircase, not for any kind of particular energy reason, but just to make sure the crystals are always illuminated. Indefensible, but beautiful. Very nice. There you go. This project is something we just won. I put it in here, there's hardly any development work on it, but just in terms of, massive curtain walls with parametric geometries. This is a tower in southern China. It's about 450 meters tall. We won it in association with the architect Hen Architects from Munich. And the team that designed this is all ex-Asymptote, all guys that worked on Yaz Island and then moved over to Hen. And they brought us in. That's how we know them. And the whole building was generated in a very kind of like Asymptote-esque manner. Whereas, you know, if you touch any surface of this building, it's always curving in three axes. There's nothing here that has yet been rationalized into conics or cylinders or any other type of platonic form. But what is going on here, curtain wall-wise, and I'm sorry, I don't really have good images of it, but this is a true performance-oriented facade. I mean, the curtain wall is so straightforward, which is that on the north face, the curtain wall is vertical, and it begins to fold within a floor around the south side of the wall. And this top part is always opaque. It's spandrel, fully insulated, and it begins to kick out. And on top, it's all photovoltaics. And the bottom is all vision glass. And that point, that datum, also rises from here down and further. So ultimately, you get almost like about 30% window-to-wall ratio on the south facade of the building with a cutoff angle essentially acting as a brise-soleil and with the maximum area of power generation. And that line, that folding curtain wall, basically steps up and up and up and up and up as it moves around. And of course, planimetrically, every floor plate is unique. So you can imagine the kind of insane complexity of trying to manage the data and the fabrication information associated with those curtain wall panels. But I mean, with the kind of knowledge capture and automation that we're dealing with now in curtain wall design, this is it's not a cheap proposal, but it's a realizable proposal. And it's a very elegant solution. We do believe, of course, once you get into the design of this, there are ways to take whole regions of the building and rationalize them and create small families of systems that start to create bits of repetition, and therefore the whole thing becomes more economical, but without diluting the kind of core concept or even the aesthetic expression of the building. So this is just now moving into schematic design. Highline 23, one of our favorite people in the world, Neil Denari, came into our office one day, almost died because he's one of my heroes, and asked us to help him build one of his first, you know, significantly scaled projects in New York City next to the High Line. We started as consultants on this project, and then it started to go into pricing before the collapse, and the numbers were astronomical that we were getting from all the qualified curtain wall contractors. And then the owner, who's kind of a visionary guy, Alf Naiman, refused to give up on the design and just engaged us in a discussion about actually doing the design build ourselves. And at this time, we had started to do certain facade design build projects, meaning basically where we would take the commercial responsibility to design, engineer, fabricate, subcontract the fabrication, subcontract the installation, and basically deliver the entire project. So, you know, there's a multi-million dollar venture, and you could call it extreme consulting if you wish, because in the end, we're not really contractors. We don't really want to be a contractor, but we do believe ultimately where empowerment comes from being responsible for the thing you can design. If you can design something to the scale of the millimeter, to a certain level of resolution where you put your life on the line and say, it will work, and I'll be commercially responsible for that, there's a lot of power. And then if you can deliver, all the better. So this project here was also done in a kind of mega panel construction. Also, I should say Alf Naiman was one of the key investors in the 111th Avenue job. So he had been fully kind of versed in China-based mega panel prefabrication. And the system you're looking at is the chassis to this curtain wall actually has a steel plate mullion with a stainless steel cladding and a semi-unitized cassette system where the keepers are basically flush with the offset laminate. So the whole thing is pretty slick and smooth. And then this is a Schüco profile that we had Schüco make all these windows, which are integrated motorized windows. So what you're looking at here is one kind of prefabricated steel chassis with the glass skinned onto it. It gets dropped in A-frames and then put onto these open-top containers. And then there's two actual types of mega panels. There's one which is the stud wall-based assembly on the sidewall, and then these stamped panels also were made by Dante Martinez in Argentina. They were shipped to Long Island, reassembled onto the backup panels made in Long Island, and then hung onto the wall. And then all of these panels here were all made in China, brought in, and then the same erector put those panels on the building. So it's quite a complicated story of coordination about how this came into being. Here's an illustration of the backup panel. This is the first trial assembly mock-up, just to understand the kind of double sloping geometry, how the frit might start to look, and trying to understand it. And then this is the first full production panel, basically made in China. This is at the factory. You can see the scale of the factory. We're not dealing with mom-and-pop operations. It's all pretty serious business. As you can see, this is the inside of the factory in China, with all of the Highline 23 panels laid out for inspection or in stages of partial assembly. And then, ta-da, they get shipped to New York. They're brought in flatbeds, just like 111th Avenue, and then dropped over the building to the back. Bang, 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 bang. They all get installed. And that's it. And I know this building's just been honored with a number of key awards, and it's one of our favorite jobs, and we're extraordinarily pleased to be a part of it. This is a project designed by Jansen Goldstein, architects in New York. It's for Holt Renfrew in Vancouver. I'll tell you one narrative that gave the birth to this project, which is Vancouver has very strict requirements on energy consumption. And there's a certain number of watts per meter squared you can use during your whole development. And the owner, which is Galen Weston, chose not to spend any of that on external lighting. So the whole idea of department store facades that are all illuminated or media walls and stuff, none of that could happen on this job. And they would put any lighting they had onto the interior of the store. So then they kind of opened up a dialogue about how to design a specular surface that had a certain kind of depth and material quality that spoke to the quality of the brand that could borrow ambient light from what is often an overcast Vancouver sky, or borrow light from ambient street lights or passing cars. And so, you know, there's a clear understanding of projects like the Maison de Verre or other kind of, you know, Hermes by Piano in Tokyo, various pixelated-based glass block facades that have these amazingly ethereal qualities. So we were interested in doing something that had this kind of bubble texture, slumped glass that actually was also frameless. And then in the spandrel zones, it would actually sit in front of a panel behind it that was a mirror and have no vertical mullion in between. So the whole thing acted as this kind of very complex mirror-like shadow box assembly that could borrow light and then basically redistribute it in ways that were quite beautiful. So there's several glass fabricators in Vancouver that are art glass guys who can do complex slumping arrangements. And Barry Allen stepped up to the plate, and it was quite lucky that he was in the region. So we started working with him to start making trial panels. Now, what you're looking at here are basically just finite element model studies of understanding what does the glass do under deflection when it has no mullion, and basically all the hotspots show that the slumping of this glass is kind of dumb. You know, you basically are locking in micro pillows and putting stress concentrations at all the fold lines, and the chances of it failing are actually reasonably high. So we started to say we need more glass. We need a resin binder that actually creates composite performance between the two pieces of glass because it had to be laminated for safety. And then this one image here shows the dampening effect of having two adjacent panels locked to the middle panel with structural silicone, because wind has a scale, it has a pattern, and when it hits one panel, it's not loading all the adjacent panels simultaneously. And so that dampening effect also, we didn't factor that into the base design, but we took it under advisement that the actual deflections will be less than what is approved by the city. So it kind of builds in a safety factor from Holt Renfrew's standpoint. So here's the grill that it was just slumped onto, and there's the oven. Basically, the glass, both sheets of glass get put onto this metal grill, the oven comes down, the hood comes down, temperature goes up. As soon as it meets the softening temperature, it starts to sag under gravity, and then you quench it within 3 seconds, and you've induced at that point about 10 millimeters of displacement in the glass panel. And if you held it longer, it would just keep going, and it would elongate and pull in at the edges and be a failure. So there's a lot of trial and error and experimentation to actually get this working to the point where we wanted it to work. So here's the first full-scale panels, edge conditions. The next thing we did as well was, this is a very fast-track project, and we had a client that was willing to fund testing simultaneous with production, which is very unusual. So what we were very concerned about, though, is that this panel ripping itself apart under thermal expansion, and that as it expands sideways and lengthwise, basically, we didn't believe the glass could resist, you know, basically the differential elongation held in by all this geometry. So we actually put it in a full rack like this. There's one very large thermal cycling test facility in Mississauga near Toronto, and we sent this across the country, and we basically put it through ambient thermal cycling and also radiant, partial radiant thermal cycling as well. And in the end, it didn't fail, and we also drove, we wanted to test its post-failure integrity. So we held it on two sides because it's only held at the top and the bottom, and then we put it, we drove basically a forklift through the glass, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. I have a video of it, but I'm not going to show it to you. And it's amazing how strong the interlayers are. It just basically sits there for minutes and minutes on end. So there's ample warning in case the stuff starts to fall out. And in the end, I mean, that's what it's about. One of my most favorite recent projects, this is the Jane's Carousel project in Dumbo in Brooklyn with Atelier Jean Nouvel. And this is a 1922 vintage carousel built by the Philadelphia Toboggan Company, which Jane Valentis, an artist, bought in 1985 and spent the last 25 years restoring it to perfection. And fortunately for her, her husband is a billionaire, David Valentis, who owns half of Dumbo and is my landlord, negotiated with the city of New York to take a chunk of Brooklyn Bridge Park in perpetuity, spend $3.5 million improving the park around that area, and then spend $8 million building the carousel enclosure, and then an endowment to support its operation for the next 300 years. So this carousel is going to be there for a while. So the whole idea is really, it's just four columns with a simple biaxially symmetrical structure. Two walls are 70-foot concertina folding aircraft hangar doors that open up, and we bought those in Switzerland and then worked with the fabricator, Bator, to modify them at length. And then the side walls are all frameless 27-foot tall acrylic panels, cast acrylic. And they're cast acrylic simply because the quality of the materiality and the imperfection in the surface was actually what was desirable. We could even specify the flatness, and we specified something less than perfect. because of that. Now, Jean actually wanted everything to be welded over 70 feet to be one single piece of monolithic acrylic. And, you know, you would say that seems like a reasonable idea. They do it on aquariums all the time. But when you get into this process and you hadn't done it before, and if you're an aquarium expert, you might not even come to this conclusion yourself. But there's a reason why it didn't work, which is that aquariums themselves have such massive thermal mass associated with it that it stabilizes the temperature of the acrylic much more than the fluctuations of the air on the other side. So those aquarium walls almost never see any thermal expansion or contraction. Whereas if you actually take a 70-foot piece of acrylic and start sticking it on roller bearings, the thing might rip itself apart. Now, this is the one instance where, because of the scale of the project and the risks associated with it, our client was not willing to build a one-to-one scale experimental mock-up to find out if it would work or not, okay? So we said, okay, we're going to accept joints. And we worked with Reynolds in Salt Lake to basically have 9-foot by 27-foot sheets of 4.5-inch cast acrylic. We put a 13-inch moment-based connection clamp underground at the base of it in order to create a fixed pin connection to reduce the deflections. By that way, we cut out 3 inches of acrylic and saved $1 million in cost. In the end, the joints are massive. And the idea of, like, stuffing silicone down the middle of the joint was really not something that was going to be acceptable to anyone. So the whole focus became really all about the joint itself at that point. And the solution to the joint, I'll have some images later, is a sputter-coated ETFE fabric occupying the space of the joint as a kind of flap, which even Hani Rashid confessed to me. He went down to the carousel a few weeks ago and started touching the gasket. He was so enamored with the gasket. And I actually told him that he can take partial credit for it because we discussed it as having a Rashid-esque aesthetic, and which is also known as a kind of Terminator 2 liquid metal aesthetic. These images here are our day at work, just so you know. There's all this digital stuff, but whiteboards and hand sketches and thousands and thousands and thousands of hand sketches is actually what we do. So this whole carousel was essentially worked out on whiteboards and then evolved through into the kind of construction document process. So anyway, here's a whole bunch of just drawings showing the kind of evolution of this. Here's the basic material. This is notionally what a gasket might have been, and then it evolved into this. And then we actually did reams of work to try and understand how ETFE adheres to Velcro, which then how does Velcro adhere to stainless steel, and then how does stainless steel adhere to acrylic? And there's like a 50-page report on compatibility and adhesion testing involving like 5 mega corporations to just figure out how to do this particular gasket. And in the end, it's nice. There is another narrative to this, which is nice. It would get very hot in the summer, even with the doors open. And we identified a problem, and we didn't want to do all the kind of thermal modeling ourselves because we weren't quite competent enough to make sure it was absolutely right. So we encouraged 2Trees to hire Atelier 10. So Paul Stoller and his guys came in to do some thermal modeling and confirmed our suspicions, which is that it can go up to about, if the doors are closed, about 65 degrees Celsius in the summer. And even with the doors open, if you have no wind, it can go up to about 45 degrees Celsius. Either way, pretty unbearable. So the notion of, so you can see the ceiling here, it's actually 50% perforated with these slats. There's 4 large extract fans up there to basically pull the air up. But there is also, in the floor, a giant geothermal labyrinth. There's a 6-foot-deep concrete geothermal labyrinth which pulls air in very slowly and then sends it up through displacement cooling into the perimeter and also around the carousel itself. And then here it is, kind of like an archaeological site, covered with snow. And so it actually has a quite nice kind of passive environmental narrative as well. The fans at the top almost never get used. They're only there in case of some emergency or some major issue. This is the only movie that I have here. See this? My daughter's middle name is Jane, so I'm going to tell her that we built it for her. This is the new extension to the Kimball Art Museum, where we're doing with an architect you may know called Renzo Piano. And it's a wonderful, wonderful project. Of course, it's quite discreetly located away from the Kimball, and the connection is mainly underground out of deference to the Lucan piece. And what you're looking at here is a couple of systems. This is a rendering, by the way. There was this travertine wall, which is now all concrete. There's a timber structure. These are all laminated timber beams. The whole roof is photovoltaic laminated glass louvers. And then there's this wall here where we're looking at both concrete mullions and glass mullions. And I just have a couple of images. This is Renzo looking at a mock-up of the timber beam and then looking at a mock-up of the cladding, and then looking at a mock-up of the photovoltaics. And what's wonderful, these are all built in Geneva, and they're all located immediately next to each other. And it was all coordinated as a process to say, okay, we want to study every aspect of this project, we want to study them together in one location, and we want to see all these elements related to each other. And then there's actually a combinatory mock-up as well that was built that shows the kind of interface between roof and wall. So these are the concrete finish studies, and this is the combinatory mock-up, basically looking at how this thing was built. Another quick one, this is the Cook J Gallery that we're doing with someone known to you, Florian Eidenberg and Jing Liu. My partner Michael took this on kind of a design build basis to develop this kind of crazy custom chainmail cladding. You can see from the massing of the building, there's these kind of accessory volumes around this kind of main volume, and then there's a staircase on the other side here, as you can see. So the mesh is not actually an enclosure. It's more just the, it is the skin, though. It is the envelope. It actually is the thing that kind of defines the edge. And looking straight on, it's just incredibly transparent, and when you look obliquely at it, all of a sudden, the mesh just becomes this kind of brilliant specular surface that's totally opaque. So it's got these kind of amazing diaphanous qualities to it. Now, the we did all this analysis of it, and also the guys in the office, mainly Jeff Koch and Evan Lavelle, both Georgia Tech guys, they went through and basically started locating every single chainmail link, because the strands, of course, change in the linkages over the various double curved surfaces as you move through this thing. So here, you can see what the material is. We then had, I have to say, every one of these links is individually formed, hand welded, and stitched. It's essentially braided, you know, the whole thing. And then the whole thing is basically thrown in a tumbler and kind of polished. So we actually engaged five different fabricators in China to produce various mock-ups to our specification, looked at quality issues, and we negotiated prices with them, and basically then supplied these meshes to the contractor in Korea for them to install. I believe the opening is this week. This is the Lincoln Square Synagogue project. This is a project where we started as consultant and also ended up doing design build. It's pretty straightforward. The architect is Setra Reddy, and I'll give credit where credit is due. The main driver for this project is a lady named Teresa Genovese, who is a graduate of this school. And she's the one that kind of drove it, and she's the one that enabled us to do design build in order to save the design. She lobbied the congregation, and we went through months and months of presentations and background checks and references and so forth to convince them that we were actually bona fide and the right people for the job. Because, you know, this is a pretty high-profile job, and for them it represents massive amounts of fundraising and risk. And, you know, the idea that they weren't getting a large integrated contractor with lots of commercial backup to do it was an unusual decision. And in fact, I give credit to this one guy named Scott Liebman, who happens to be the managing director of UBS Real Estate America, who said, I get it. Okay, you guys, you're artists, basically, and you don't want any responsibility, but you guarantee me you'll give me a code-compliant performing facade for a reasonable price. We're like, yeah. So it's a Zen contract. We actually have no guaranteed schedule, mutual hold harmless clauses, no litigation. Everyone is obligated to come to the table in good faith and negotiate disputes. It's really Zen. And it's worked out. It has worked out because everyone's done what they said they would do. So it is very digital. This one here starts with these hand-drawn curves, which then are rationalized into this kind of integer optimization to generate the wireframe for the curves. And we played with Teresa to work out what this geometry would actually be. We're looking at now is four superimposed curves. And then as I get into these drawings here, I also will give next credit, which is there's several people in my office that are very instrumental for this, but one of them is Ramona Albert, who also is a graduate of this school, who was the project manager for the design build portion of this from my side, and now she's now teaching at Syracuse. This drawing here, which she made, is completely rhetorical and totally useless. Because no one has the ability to verify the information on this drawing. This drawing is simply produced to submit to the construction manager for their file, and they have no ability to review or approve it, because everything is in the model. And unless someone's basically getting into the wireframe and interrogating the geometry, they can't actually verify this. What they can verify is certain coordinate setout points, key datums, things like that as we go. So this model basically got built up piece by piece by piece by piece with a series of master parts, a series of adaptive parts that then can get instantiated into local addresses. And upon instantiation, two things happen. There's a series of 2D drawings that get generated automatically. It takes a lot of programming to get those document templates to work, actually. It's not very cost effective, but we like doing it. And the second part of it actually generates whole series of CATIA part files in pre-labeled indexes and generates the nomenclature for the part numbers in a way that we predetermine upon instantiation. So this is the kind of subroutine that allows projects, say, like the Hen Tower in southern China, to handle that kind of geometry with a huge amount of construction specificity. And this, for me, is kind of like the holy grail of where the whole industry is going. We happen to do this mostly on a CATIA platform, but frankly, we think there's going to be many ways to do this kind of work in the future. This project was also a catalyst for us to set up our own small digital fabrication workshop in Brooklyn, which was more just a glorified, indulgence project on our side to basically have the bully pulpit of saying, yeah, you know, we designed and engineered this thing, we had the extrusions milled, and then we basically cut them ourselves and produced all the G-code to do it. And soup to nuts, we can say, yeah, check, done. But frankly, it's very inefficient to try and make things yourself. It's better to actually understand what kind of information, what kind of file formats, what kind of anything that your fabricator needs. Because the idea that there's like 100,000 different fab shops anywhere in the world, you could work with any one of them. Right? So, but if you are owning the design to the level of fabrication and not abdicating that design, then you're in a very powerful place because you can then engage the world and it's very, very straightforward. I mean, there's lots of sort of, you know, micro fab shops setting up, but I'm talking about large scale stuff, just calling up a glass supplier anywhere in the world and saying, here's my cutting list, give me some glass. You know, as long as you specified and engineered it and you have a reason to buy it, it's very powerful. If a guy is cutting sheet metal, well, he really only needs 2D cutting files. He doesn't need 3D CATIA part files. If a guy has extrusions, but he has to do a whole series of end mills, well, he might need, a post-process 3D file into a series of milling instructions for his particular piece of equipment. You know, so what equipment is he using, and do you actually know how to play with him and their person that's actually, you know, programming their equipment? So this job was the kind of linchpin job for us to get under the hood and be able to engage in a much more broader way, and we've rolled all of these lessons back into every consulting project we do. And then it becomes all about what is the appropriate format, appropriate level of information relative to our scope of work on any particular project. Is it quantities? Is it measurement? Is it actual pre-engineering? Is it production side? Are we working on the contractor side of the table? And all those questions are first principles, critical, and they're very kind of, you need to ask them in order to not generalize about what these tools are doing and how to use them. We are using laminated fabric within the glass itself, which is something we actually try to do on CCTV. So it's kind of borrowed from then. But in this particular case, yours truly being the design builder and having the commercial risk, I could actually fund the testing of this particular Trevira product laminated with SGP between glass, and I could use the testing labs up in Canada to do this and then basically build confidence in my own ability to do it. By the way, just contractually, the way that was set up is if it failed and I said, I don't want to do it because it represents too much risk, then the architect had an obligation to develop frit patterns and do a printed version of the actual fabric. So there was this kind of like, you know, double path being pursued at the same time with some sort of fail-safe backup just in case, because we couldn't lose the time in the process. What you're looking at here are all the fixtures we use for milling the various extrusions. I probably didn't mention that all the generative geometry for the wall is all spline-based. It's not radial arcs, which then implies that every transom on the inside of the glass is all unique. So every single extrusion is a unique end cut, which is what you're looking at here. So the clamps basically hold the extrusion. We mill a suite of extrusions at the same time using feature cam, and just run the macro, and then these are the actual cutting profiles that we get. And you'll see why this kind of looks like what it does. So we built a small-scale trial assembly mock-up just to prove that it works for ourselves. We did this without anyone else's help. And then we hired our installer to come in, disassemble it, and reassemble it so they would have conceptual buy-in. And at that point, we could start negotiating with them on the install side once they really understood the system. So that was an advantage that we had in pulling this off. And what you're looking at here is a CNC cut, a little acrylic lens that gets inset within each transom. And this line here represents the floor level. So this is all spandrel below the floor. But there's a linear LED that sits down here, which then shoots light up, and it goes through the lens and catches the back of the whole thing. So every single panel is internally illuminated in the facade. So here's the kind of early mock-up of the fabric under sunlight, and then this is the lighting mock-up. Lots of tweaking going on, little redirects and so forth. Susan Tillotson was a lighting consultant. And then here's all the extrusions, every one of these unique, and then the pre-assembly in our own workshop. We hired a couple of carpenters who we still employ right now, going job to job to job, to do all of this metalwork assembly in Brooklyn here. And then there's the actual site. One thing you'll see here, working with Barone Steel out of New Jersey, every hole for our brackets is pre-located and CNC cut. So we took their Tekla model, we put all the holes on it, we sent it back to them. They did a couple of trial pieces. We went out to their shop, verified, and then gave them a release to produce it. And then there was a certain guaranteed installation tolerances. And then quickly I'll go through the whole installation sequence here. So you can see the whole thing is basically a kind of a very complex stick-built assembly. And the glass is all in. It's all site structurally siliconed. And this is just a couple of months ago. Even the rigging here, we have a there's a guy named Greg Beach. I don't know if you guys know him, but he is like the best logistics consultant in the world in terms of custom rigging. He can design monorails, cranes, you know, all sorts of crazy rigs. So we have this monorail on top here, which has a double-decker rig, and all of these platforms are retractable in and out, so they could have a two-man crew doing the site structural silicone from one part of the panel, and then the next guy picks up below on the next part of the panel, and then they can actually move in and out to get access to the underslung areas of the curved wall. So this whole thing was rigged out, and it costs about $140,000 for design engineering, you know, the leasing and rental of this rig, and all that gets washed into the total cost. Now, the industry basically offered this facade for about $800 a square foot when it was bid, and in the end, it's being delivered for $500 a square foot. And it's not cheap, okay? Granted, it was never meant to be cheap, but still, that's a massive difference, like 40% difference. And this is conceptually what it's going to be when it's all done. I'm going to stop with this project here. This is going to be the last job, and then we'll wrap this up. This is another project that we won by invited design competition by Louis Vuitton. It was a curious thing. The design director for LV in Paris happened to be one of the architects we worked with at KPF previously. And then he had a conundrum. He was responsible for getting a high-profile, innovative, interesting facade for their flagship store in Singapore, the ION development. And the owner of ION is Capital Land, and if anyone knows who Capital Land is, it's basically the investment arm of the Singaporean government. So it's basically the Singaporean government dealing with LVMH. So that's the kind of setup between these two mega corporations. And Capital Land was basically saying, like, you know, if you want this pole position, if you want this particular spot, which is the best retail spot because it actually faces the street and it's got the best kind of exposure, blah, 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 then they had to deliver something. So LV had a few of their excellent architects that they often work with, like Jun Aoki and Kumiko Inui and Carbondale out of Paris and others. And Car Hua, the KPF guy, called me up out of the blue and just said, Mark, we know you're not normally doing kind of like architectural design work stuff and you're doing mostly consulting or design build, but we have this notion that maybe you'd want to do this, maybe you want to try and take this on. And he had a thesis, which is that if conceptually we could propose something that they found interesting, then we had a better chance of executing it on time than anyone else because of our industry knowledge. And his obligation was from competition to opening day, he had 12 months. 12 months. I'm from competition stage. So it's pretty fast. So at the competition stage, we developed this idea of basically taking the lease line, which is a curved line, which all of these never really had to deal with before. Most of the buildings are all Cartesian. And then to increase the length of it, mainly from an experiential standpoint. So when you actually begin to come close to it, the facade begins to sort of engage you physically, changes your understanding of your peripheral vision and what you're seeing. And then when you pull out from it, actually kind of, you know, presents itself in a more kind of flattened manner. And we intentionally took a chance to move away from what Jun Aoki's been doing for them, which is always about superposition of textures and materials, lights, moire effects, and so forth, always based on a graphic device, and also always using LV motifs in a kind of very intentional way. And there's only four LV motifs, the damier, which is the check, the flower, the star, and the monogram, all which have their own historical origins. And so we actually rejected that, which was a huge gambit, and just basically said, we're going to marry ourselves to the idea that LV's brand is all about artisanal quality and the legacy of the brand over 140 years, and we want to do something through the pure manipulation of a single material with no additional representation, no super graphics, no frits, no printed interlayers, nothing, just glass. And the idea that you could slump texture glass and then curve glass, and then use it in kind of, it's framed vertically, but horizontally unframed, and then illuminate it in a kind of very intentional way that works with the texturing of the glass to create specific effects. So that was the kind of competition idea combined with the geometry. So surface quality plus geometry plus light, that's it. And then we knew that all of these things, the signs, the vitrines, the entrances, the transparencies, the monogram, is essentially a kit of prepackaged LV signage elements that come from what's called the LV Bible, which we have a copy of. And you just basically then work with them and their branding people to locate the signage and branding onto this, otherwise what is really just a surface about experience. So the next part is during the competition, we put together a document saying who we wanted to work with. We wanted to say, We want Gartner. We said we know LV only works with Gartner and MBM for Asian retail projects. Out of the two, we want to work with Gartner. Not for any particular reason, but basically based on relationships, because we hadn't worked with MBM that much. We knew Gartner very well. Next, we wanted to work with Fusion Glass in the United Kingdom because they're the only glass slumping, laminating, curving company that can operate at a sufficiently industrialized scale to meet the production schedule. And that's understanding that, you know, Sunglass in Italy can do fantastic curved glass, can't do slumping and texturing very well. Cucursa, fantastic curving, weak on laminating and slumping and texturing. And the thing is the laminating technology here had to be resin-based, using an acrylic resin, and not sheet-based. And Cucursa wasn't spooled up to do resin-based laminating, because it's more of an artisanal process for most people these days than doing sheet laminates, which are more reliable. So anyway, you'd have to know all of that with this specific technical design at the competition stage to even know who could actually build it. And there was only one company in the world that was suitable. And so when we when LV basically said, okay, we're in with your idea, we're interested in building it, we understand you want Gartner. And so they called Gartner and they said, Gartner, go to the UK, vet this glass fabricator. If you say yes, we won the competition. So there was this pre-verification of the actual glass fabricator at the proposal stage in order to ensure that the schedule could be met. And so we built all that on a huge other kind of number of projects and experiences and relationships in order to kind of play in that. And we're very interested moving forward as we do design things that we are taking, you know, benefit of those specific relationships to move things forward. So this thing here, this is in the evening. The whole interior is basically just suspended tube steel mullions that are moment connected at one end and fixed on the other. Even the whole trim down here is all suspended. One of the challenges here, there was also a pedestrian subway going underneath the store at this point, and you couldn't actually structurally connect to the slab because it was too weak. So the whole facade had to be suspended on top of that. So there was a lot of digital modeling, but of course, to make it even moderately pragmatic, we used extruded geometries based on the curve as opposed to trying to do double curve geometries, which was maybe the next phase. So here's the sand bed. The glass being slumped. This is the slumping oven in the UK. And we had Fusion Glass in a very fast period of time make about 50 of these samples, combining the line textures with the actual surface issues of the glass. Because some cases we wanted the flat areas to be perfectly transparent, but to have this lensing effect. In other cases, we wanted to break the glass surface and have lenses that were less perfect. And there's a lot of complexity in how to do this. And then this is the first kind of lighting mock-up to get buy-in on the lighting strategy. So we're basically down-lighting the textured glass to see if it would work. We're pretty convinced here. And then we moved on to the next scale of mock-up, which is a 5-meter by 11-meter full-scale prototype, which was also used to study curtains and other things that were going on. And you can see here in these images, this starts to evolve this kind of linen-like quality to the glass, which, you know, people have asked me if I don't tell them, it's like, what is that? I mean, this image, you could think it's metal. You could think it's spun, milled metal. You could think it's sputtered concrete or GFRC. And it's this kind of material change and abstraction that we're really, really interested in. Even here, you can see different panels. Like this one looks like it's steel or something. And I would also point out that it matters here. This panel, these two here, have an acrylic resin, and these panels here have a urethane resin. And there's actually a color difference, which is actually quite striking. It's not just a lighting effect in that case. And then the final store is done. You know what? There's a lot of other stuff here, but I am going to just show you the one thing. Yeah, here. VACO. Because VACO was simultaneous with LV, and it was after Holt Renfrew and Beijing Books building and all the other kind of slumping, curving, texturing glass projects that we're doing. And there is this kind of evolutionary continuum between these. And, you know, Josh Ramis and I had a very specific discussion about Holt Renfrew, which he appreciated technically, but we both said, yes, but these bubbles creating these stress concentrations is really a not very technically sensible solution in the spirit of a formal idea that seemed kind of residual in the end. You know, and so the idea evolved to say, can we do something that is slumped, textured, and curved, but also insulated, to have an insulated low-E glass panel that was a little bit more responsible from an energy standpoint. And this was also happening simultaneously, not that we worked on it, but the Herzog De Meuron project for the concert hall in Europe. And a lot of these experimentations are running in parallel. Different companies are trying to do different things like that. Politically, one thing that happened here, which is the Turks, VACO basically, and rightfully so, said, we want it made in Turkey. So we said, who's the best glass company? Lamb Glass. We said, Lamb Glass, we met them. We said, can we work with you to develop this? And they said, well, we've never done this before, but we'll try. So this little X here, this is the first try. This is them basically taking a small piece of glass on a ceramic mold in an oven saying, okay, yeah, well, cool, it works. And then this is the next one, starting to get a little bit bigger. And then in this one, this is even bigger still. And then we finally get to full scale, and the whole thing works. And I'm just going to tell you, X is not Josh Ramos branding the building with his own Rex. It actually came out of a technical issue, which is that if you're going to use an insulated low-E glass, the low-E coating could not have been slumped without destroying the coating. So the interior glass of this assembly is flat, only the outboard part is curved. The second thing is we wanted and we needed a continuous insulated glass edge seal between the two panels. So we needed a geometry on the outside panel that resolved into a flat geometry to match the other panel behind it, so you could have an off-the-shelf spacer that was reliable. The next thing is we did CFD modeling to understand the heat buildup in the cavity if we did have a bubble geometry that looked like this, because that's actually where we were going initially. And the thesis here was to generate something that was formally beautiful, quite reflective, but that also acted as a structural stiffener in order to reduce the weight of the glass, which yielded both a cost and a seismic benefit. Now, a mullion obviously would have been more efficient in doing that, but the mullionless idea was what it was all about. So we get to this point of building up this issue. We found that in the hot Turkish summers that the heat buildup in the cavity became so large and the volumetric expansion of the air was so big that the in-plane stresses on the seals blew the seals out. So what we wanted to do was then minimize the volume of the slumped area inside the cavity while generating the maximum structural stiffness as an effect. And then that happened within a certain amount of slumping, which is only about 40, 50 millimeters. And with this X geometry, we actually got maximum structural stiffness with the minimum volume. And actually, technically, that's how this whole thing kind of came about. And then just to, not that I love bolt fittings, but we did integrated fittings on the interior laminated panel, which don't come all the way to the end. So they actually stop inboard of the cavity, and that's how we hung the panels on the building. And it's images like this, just like the LV project, is really, in a sense, what we're after, is these kind of like moments on the project. Anyway, so thank you for your attention. I'm going to stop there. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much, Mark. We have time for a few questions. We just say thank you for a wonderful talk. Very impressive. This is deep knowledge of materials, of who can actually make some of these components, the combination of engineering and design. Any questions from the audience?
Thanks for a wonderful talk. I'm just wondering what kinds of experiments and facades you think you'll be doing 15 years from now.
I almost don't know how to answer that question. I like it, though, because people have been pushing us to speculate more. We actually kind of have an anti-speculative kind of point of view, somewhat intentionally. I mean, because we're so just deep into the projects, into every challenge in front of us. And, you know, my preface with the question about interpreting or trying to understand our clients' culture and values and the architects program, not just values, but also, I would say, artistically trying to understand where our clients are actually heading formally and intellectually. Because part of what we do is, you know, because we're a fairly well-educated multidisciplinary team that believe that we're actually culturally articulate about, you know, our broader architectural concerns, is that we are kind of like heading off or being able to anticipate where our clients go and then be able to kind of engage with them where that is. So one project I didn't show, like which is a Novartis project with Sejima in Switzerland, started off with a party and a diagram which is wholly irresponsible. And Matthias Schuller and I shared a dinner one night thinking about the job and just said, okay, we're going to agree almost as a pact to suspend our disbelief in the diagram and then basically set about saying, okay, so given that we have these parameters in place, what can we do? What can we do to solve this? And we actually came up with a completely first principles-based innovative cladding system, which had never been built before. It did actually have some problems, partly based on contractor issues and so forth. But that's the kind of, I guess, the sort of nexus. It really is, what I'm trying to say is between the kind of point of origination of a job and then our kind of super detailed understanding of all sorts of materials and technologies and systems and costs and cultures, the ability to leverage all of that and join with them moving forward. I do believe, of course, the energy issue is massive and huge. And my experience is that so many cultures and states and cities and countries, whatever it is, has poor legislation. Certain countries are getting way ahead of the curve, like England. Korea just implemented a new energy code, which is very, very stringent. And it will get better, but it needs to be legislated from top down. But what I'm finding as well is that so many of the people we work with don't appreciate all the factors that go into actually achieving performance. I mean, there are many companies out there that get it. They do get it, and there's lots of advocates out there. But it's not broad-based. And we're seeing people detailing stuff that, you know, just frankly doesn't work. Or projects that we see in New York where architects are self-certifying compliance with New York State Energy Code, and because there's no enforcement and builders can really do whatever they want on site, in the end, they're nowhere near Energy Code compliant. There's no chance they are. We are seeing things improve. One project we're quite proud of, which I haven't assembled a sequence of yet, is the Via Verde housing project in the Bronx with Grimshaw, which is an affordable housing job mixed with market rate units. And, you know, we're doing pretty much almost everything you can on that project, in terms of, outboard air water barriers, outboard insulation, beyond that, rain screen design, exterior breeze soleils, properly insulated buildings, proper window to wall ratios, integrated photovoltaics, prefabricated units to reduce, material waste and consumption, maximize recyclability, et cetera. You know, the list is very long of all the things you can do to improve embodied energy usage and energy performance in buildings. And there are many buildings that are doing that. You mentioned in the introduction, I didn't show it, but also linked hybrid housing, you know, with its 660 geothermal wells, its evaporative cooling system. It also has, double directional brise soleils built into the punch windows. It has exterior motorized blinds. It also has four units per floor, so it has cross ventilation every unit, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. List goes on there. We are also the King Abdullah University of Science and Technology in Jeddah with HOK. We did all 25 buildings there, and it's a 6 million square foot project, which is the world's largest LEED certified building. And what I love about the project is that it was designed at a kind of master environmental conceptual scale, where, you know, you have all these open atriums, you have a massive plenum. It's like a gigantic version of the Columbia Journalism School project, where all the heat rises up and then moves laterally into a solar chimney. And that then induces a stack effect, which then draws water, air over the evaporative pools, and then creates this kind of constant breeze around the whole project. So I do think, moving forward, and 15 years is maybe not that far out, that you will see a convergence of landform architecture, urban design, macro planning of environmental systems, implementing all these things, where if you do take that as a kind of mandatory priority, all of the facade systems essentially fall into line. They actually all start doing their role as part of a kind of a macro agenda. And on certain projects, we are seeing that happening.
Could you explain your relationship to the architect a little bit more? Because it seems
combative and adversarial.
Because it seems to me that you're actually creating the form of the building by the facade, and that you must be influencing the ultimate result significantly.
Well, in deference to the architects, I mean, they are the authors ultimately of the work in an editorial capacity, if you know what I mean. Like, in the end, we're not making decisions. And it is a very collaborative environment out there. As you know, there are many high-profile, accomplished consultancies, and we work with all of them as well. I mean, it's kind of like a roving pack moving from project to project around the world. And we know how to play with each other, and that's working well. And then with specific architects, they're all very different, and it depends whether you're dealing with the principal themselves or whether there's associates or project leaders that you're working with. So sometimes our relationship with the project leaders is very, very close and intimate. We're peers, we're friends, and so forth, and the relationship is very casual in that sense. The actions that get taken in the workplace often come out of very casual, informal dialogue and relationships, and that's very effective. When we're dealing with someone who, frankly, is 25 or 30 years older than us, who's a Pritzker laureate, and there's an arm's length relationship, we don't have that necessarily. I can say specifically an architect like Renzo Piano isn't that. He's actually very engaged and very personable and very democratic in many ways about accumulating information, soliciting opinion, and then integrating it and ultimately working with the owner to get that, whereas others are not. And I would say in terms of architects who are more our peers, we can have a very large influence. And then in others, there is a more territorial relationship, and we don't. We play a more technical and consultative role, and we generally understand those personalities well enough not to rain on anybody's parade.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.